But of course, anybody who has a chronic fatigue syndrome, their mitochondria are going slow. And so they go into anaerobic metabolism very early on. They just have to take a few paces and they're overwhelming their mitochondria. And in that event, they're producing lactic acid. And one of the problems of lactic acid is that inhibits mitochondrial function. In fact, I'm coming to the view that probably this is a natural break that has evolved through evolution to stop mitochondria racing out of control and get running so fast that they outstrip their supply of energy, of fuel and oxygen, and don't deliver energy efficiently to the body. But the clinical gem here is we have to pace activity very carefully, because if you switch into anaerobic metabolism, you make the mitochondria go even slower. Now, the difference between normal fatigue, because guess what, I shall feel tired at the end of the day, and pathological fatigue is the delayed factor. So if you have a patient that you're seeing or yourself, and you do things one day and you pay for it the next day, you get post-exertional malaise, you get delayed fatigue, then that will switch you into anaerobic metabolism and inhibit mitochondria even more. So pacing activity is very boring, but absolutely essential. What else do we find on mitochondria? Again, products of fermenting gut, well, we've done that. Hair dyes, often see hair dyes on mitochondria, so avoid things. And all these things we have found, parabens, polybrominated biphenyls, pesticides, nickel mercuries, we have to get rid of those. Malondialdehyde is commonly comes up, and that we can sort by improving antioxidant status. And then, as I mentioned, we can get toxins from infections, mycotoxins, viral protein, and bacterial endotoxin. So hopefully at this stage, we have our mitochondria in a fit state to respond, and then we have to control them. We don't want them going too fast. We don't want them going too slowly. And of course, from an evolutionary perspective, it's absolutely vital to match energy delivery with energy demands. To do otherwise is not going to work, because if mitochondria go too fast unnecessarily, then we use up a lot of food, and that's not good for survival, because our human populations in the distant past were largely controlled by availability of food. And then, of course, we need to be able to gear up energy delivery so that, you know, when we need energy for the purpose of hunting or killing, that is available to us. So matching up energy delivery and expenditure with the thyroid accelerator pedal and the adrenal gearbox is a critical and vital part of survival. Now, all these regimes to do this, I call them groundhog regimes. Groundhog, and that's named after a film called Groundhog Day, where there's a time loop and our hero in the film does things wrong and then goes back to the beginning of the day and tries to repeat the day doing things correctly. So that's why I call them groundhog regimes, because I keep coming back to them. And we should all be doing Groundhog Basic all the time. And the actual nitty-gritty details are there on my website and also in the books. Groundhog Acute is what we should be putting in place at the first hint of any infection, iodine with a salt pipe and vitamin C. And then Groundhog Chronic is what we do in the long term when we have a chronic illness or a chronic infection. And my book, Ecological Medicine, has now been translated into Polish, where all these things are detailed.